shows up again, cucks. I'm back, bitches. Man, I don't think I've ever been able to come up with 25 reasons quicker than I did for this video. I'm not even joking. I ended my other video at around 12:35 Eastern time, motherfuckers. And around 12:40, I finished all the little uploading things, you know, to make it so the video processes. And now it's 12:45 and I've already begun this video. So it took me less than 5 minutes to come up with 25 reasons why Kazuchika Okada sucks ass. Now, what this tells us is this. Number one, it is indisputable that this guy sucks, right? If I come up with 25 what I think are legitimate reasons, and I'd like to see people say they're not legitimate. I'd like to hear you in the comments, motherfuckers, telling me that my reasons are bullshit. But before we get to the reasons, I just gotta say, during the time that I was taping, I guess, recording my other video, we got a new subscriber, so he deserves a shout out. We got Too Debonair 1914, motherfuckers. Too Debonair 1914. He's got a dove and a sigma on his little picture, which I'm sure means something, but I can't read it because it's too small up in this bitch. All right. Now, without further ado, motherfuckers, the video that has been requested by many and desired by all and hated by the lover. It's time for the haters 25 reasons why Kazuchika Okada sucks ass. All right, let's get to it, motherfuckers. Reason one, he has different hair colors every time I see him, and they all look like shit. All right, that's reason number one. This guy colors his hair more times than a little girl, you know what I'm saying? It is weird, and I do not like it, you know? Now, a lot of people that are ignoramuses might think, oh, this is just Japanese, oh, Harajuku district. No, fam, been to Tokyo, it ain't like that, motherfuckers. You'd see a few people with colored hair, but most people are normal. That's another video. I should do a video about Japan, because I love that son of a bitch. Anyways, reason number two. He has about 5 moves, and all of these moves completely suck ass, all right? He does like a bullshit-looking AA. He does an elbow drop. He does a drop kick. He does a flapjack. And he does his finisher. And periodically, he'll do like the regal stretch, but that's not in his repertoire. His matches typically are just a bunch of clothesline fests. Let's be real, right? Which leads us to reason number three, cucks. Reason three, he has a clothesline finisher, but is about 145 pounds, so it's completely unbelievable. Now let's compare that to JBL's clothesline from hell, one of the best finishers of all time. JBL would pretty much dodge a guy, typically, incoming into the turnbuckle. He'd run against the ropes at full speed. He was about 290 pounds, and then he would put his entire body weight into a clothesline, taking the head off of his opponents, right? This is a move that he could believably do to anyone, including Big Show, right? It's believable that a big man like Big Show being attacked, like, with the arm of a 290-pound man would fall like a piece of shit, right? Now, maybe he wasn't 290, but he was a big motherfucker, let me tell you, right? So, whereas Okada is about 145 pounds, skinny fat, and he does this, like, ripcord clothesline, right? It doesn't even look like it hurts, you know? And, like, people sometimes no-sell it, and it's just a bullshit finisher. I don't like it at all, motherfuckers. Reason number four, and this is part of a subset of reasons, but I didn't put them in order. Reason number four, he stole his entire gimmick from the very underrated D'Angelo De Niro from TNA, motherfuckers. Now, for those of you that might not know, for those of you that may have started watching wrestling after WrestleMania 29, let me tell you a little bit about this guy called D'Angelo De Niro. So in the reboot of ECW, right, there was a wrestler called Sylvester Turkai, motherfuckers. Sylvester Turkai's gimmick was that he was like an MMA fighter, right? And his manager, which was presented as his corner man, was a guy called Elijah Burke, right? Elijah Burke was athletic, and he had a look, and he had unbelievable levels of charisma that WWE did not capitalize on. I don't know why. I think they didn't capitalize on it because they just didn't know, right? He was someone that even my friends that don't watch wrestling were like, this guy should be a star. You know what I mean? So anyways, D'Angelo De Niro gets released or whatever, and he ends up in TNA. But in TNA, they retweak his gimmick into, in my opinion, one of the most original, one of the great gimmicks of the last decade and a half. You know what I mean? Like, it really was a legit gimmick. It's one of the last creative gimmicks. You know, I'd say like the Kurt Angle as like the unaware heel gimmick. You know, the Olympic hero who's basically a heel but doesn't realize it.
right? That's a great gimmick, which they later tried to do with Bo Dallas, which I think it would have been great, but they didn't really go with it. That gimmick is great. Bad News Barrett I like, but I understand it's not that great. The Shield is a good gimmick because the Shield is like basically a tactical force, right? They're present. I mean, now it doesn't matter because now all of them ended up becoming champions. Even Dean Ambrose, who's the worst one of the three. But in the beginning, it was like the Shield versus the team of like Sheamus, Daniel Bryan, and John Cena. And JBL would say, like, in common commentary, he's like, the Shield is the favorite maggot, right? Because the Shield was presented as like just a team, right? Whereas Daniel Bryan, Sheamus, and John Cena individually are considered superior to the individual members of the Shield. As a team, the Shield would basically find a way to eliminate the opposition, and then someone would hit like a spear, like Roman Reigns would hit like a spear or something, and they'd win like that, right? They'd win a hard-fought battle that was contingent upon their teamwork, right? Like a lot of times in Shield matches, this was part of their gimmick, motherfuckers. A lot of times, like someone would sacrifice himself. You'd push one guy out of the way, and he'd take like a finisher, and then the other guy would do like a low blow or something, let's say, and then Roman Reigns would come in and spear the person, and then they'd win like that, right? So it was all about like the greater good of the team. That was a good gimmick. And then D'Angelo De Niro was a great gimmick because the gimmick was that he's this street hustler. Holy shit, my other video, motherfuckers! And we're back. I had to take a few minutes to really quickly put that video up on YouTube so it uploads, you know, so I don't waste time. But there you go, motherfuckers. That's proof right there that it took me very little time to write these reasons about Okada, all right? Now back to reason number four. He stole his gimmick from D'Angelo De Niro. D'Angelo De Niro was presented as this almost like a street hustler, right? He was like a prophet. You know what I'm saying? The kind of guy like just like a hustler, like a guy that like takes advantage of you because he's more charismatic and like more savvy, more street savvy, right? This was a great gimmick because he was like athletically gifted, right? He gave himself a new finisher, basically, right? Eventually, well, not a new finisher. It was just like, you know, an extension of his other finishers that he used to use. But eventually he had like a little double knee to the face thing. But that's later. Who cares about that? The point is, D'Angelo De Niro would come out and he would wave, he would open his arms wide, just like Okada does, and money would fall from the sky, right? Okada stole this directly from him. And now you're wondering to yourself, well, how do you know he stole it from him? Maybe it was parallel thinking like Amy Schumer. Let me tell you why, motherfuckers, in later reasons. Reason number five. Which is kind of like an appetizer to what I just said. Okada was a TNA jobber. Now, TNA was full of stars, and somewhere down the line, as part of their exchange program, they had people like Naito, a few guys from Dragon Gate, which in my opinion were better. But and then they had Okada as a jobber, right? So he was a jobber in TNA. So as far as I'm concerned, this guy's a jobber for life, right? And he wasn't just like he didn't start out as a jobber. Like Austin Aries started out as a jobber. Alex Shelley started out as a jobber. But eventually they were developed. But not Okada, because they were like, get this asshole out of here. This guy sucks, you know? Reason number six. He is overrated by the Smarks. The Smarks pretend they've seen every Okada match and that he objectively is an incredible wrestler. You have not seen every Okada match. You started watching New Japan probably like either when Jericho joined or if you're a real beard, you probably watched a few years before that. Like, I watched a few matches here and there before that, and I remember people being like, wow, Okada's so great. Like, even the announcers, they're like, Okada. But even at this year's Wrestle Kingdom, I saw part of it, and like, Okada, like, Don Cowles was like, I don't care what you say. The best wrestling in the world is here. No, it's not. No, it's not, motherfucker. No, it's not. Even your best guy went to AEW, where he's now basically a jobber. But that's neither here nor there. Reason number seven. Dave Meltzer, he literally said this, motherfuckers. Dave Meltzer said that he might be one of the best wrestlers alive. And then he said, he might be one of the best wrestlers of all time. Now, I honestly think that if I sit down here and start listing wrestlers, I can come up with easily 100 wrestlers that are better than Okada, ranging anywhere from Shawn Michaels, Sting, Kurt Angle, Triple H, Taker, Kane, Austin, Rock, Ric Flair, did I say Triple H, Randy Orton, Batista, Goldberg, motherfuckers, Velveteen Dream, pretty much everyone on the roster now, let's be real, right? But ranging from that caliber to beyond that, like even like a Crash Holly, I would say that Crash Holly is superior to him. But that's neither here nor there. Let's move on from that right there. Dave Meltzer says he's one of the best of all time. That's just the most disingenuous thing ever. If Dave Meltzer were to pick the top 10 wrestlers and Okada was anywhere like number one, number two, or number three, that's just ridiculous. That's just foolish to me. So reason number eight, and this is a very important reason, motherfuckers. No one can explain to me why he is good. Some YouTuber, some nerd YouTuber, was doing like a live stream, a review of Raw, and I decided to join just to talk some shit, you know what I'm saying? And some people were saying like, oh, like, and I got into a little argument with one of those people saying Okada sucks, right? The YouTuber was like, Okada doesn't suck, he's a star. We'll get to that in a bit, right? And I'm thinking to myself, yo, can anyone explain why he's good? And the answers I got were your typical, like, liberal excuses, right? Like, you know when you talk to a liberal and you're like, hey, man, you know, like I'm sure, you know, global warming is a thing. You know, I'm not saying it's not, right? But it's like, are the implications of it really as severe as people have been saying they are? Because I heard that in fifth grade, they were telling me that, like, Manhattan would be flooded because the ice caps in the North Pole would melt, right? Al Gore said it too, right? And people are like, no, that's not what's going to happen. Global warming is real. And you know, you might be like, well, I'm not saying it's not real. Like, it's indisputable that the earth is warming up, but are the consequences really that? And they're like, well, and then here it is, the liberal, like, super argument. Well, if you don't get it, you just never are going to understand. Or, oh, if you don't get it, why don't you go Google it? Just shut the fuck up. Why don't you don't treat me like a retard and just tell me. Tell me why. Tell me why, despite everyone being wrong about the polar ice caps melting, why global warming is a threat, right? Not saying it's not happening, but why is it this huge threat, right? So liberals do this a lot, and it's not just liberals, of course, but liberals do this a lot, and a lot of people in this little chat did the same thing to me. I'm like, why is Okada good? And they're like, well, if you don't see why he's good, then you'll never get it. And I'm like, okay, that's not an answer. And then someone's like, he's good because his work speaks for himself. You see, this is called a horrible argument in the laws of argumentation, motherfuckers. Because if an argument can be used to explain everything, it's a shit argument. If someone says to you, man, why is the sky blue? And then you don't know why it's blue, right? Because of the what is it, bifurcation of lights, whatever it's called, you know, the diffusion of lights, right? You know, you might say something like, well, if you don't know why the sky is blue, then I can't help you, right? You can do that about anything. I could be like, hey, why is 1 + 1 = 8? And someone's like, well, if you don't know why 1 + 1 = 8, then I can't help you, right? It's a shit argument. So nobody has any arguments as to why Okada is objectively good. You can say what you want about me. You can say I'm a Cena fanboy, but I can list reasons why Cena's great, you know? I can list reasons why Batista's great. I can list reasons why Goldberg's great. I can list 25 motherfuckers why Okada sucks ass. And as a matter of fact, this leads us to reason number 9, motherfuckers. Reason number 9. Okada has multiple records in New Japan, and people think that this means anything, right? It means absolutely zero, right? If WWE, like WWE has done this quite a bit, right? That, like, the New Day, for example, is the longest reigning team ever, right? They're the longest reigning tag team champs ever. Now, the previous record was held by, like, Axe and Smash, Demolition or whatever. And then before that, like, a second best was Paul London and Brian Kendrick, right? Now, WWE was like, all right, we need to give New Day, like, some sort of, like legitimacy, like a legacy, right? So what are we going to do? We're going to make them the longest reigning champs. Cool, right? Totally cool, right? Same thing. Asuka has the longest undefeated streak in the history of wrestling, right? Now, a lot of times they manipulate this, right? So, for example, eventually someone's going to have, like a over 1 year reign with a universal title. And they will be the longest reigning universal champion ever, right? This neglects the fact that the universal championship, right, is just like a rehashed championship, right? It's like a new championship. So people are like, oh, he's the longest reigning world heavyweight champion. Yeah, no one else can be that anymore because the championship is inactive, right? But like to make someone, for example, the longest reigning intercontinental champion, that's a different game altogether, right? It's like that title's been around for a fucking hot minute. So you can't do that, right? So, it's kind of the same thing with Okada, right? People are like, all right, we need to make this guy the longest reigning champion. We need to give this guy the greatest cumulative reign, right? So we can present him as the next big deal, right? They're using this thing, like, they're specifically doing it. That's why people like, was like Charlotte or whatever who broke the record that AJ Lee had, whatever, some bullshit women's record was broken, right? Becky might break it again, who the fuck knows, right? The point is, like, as soon as they break it, boom, they drop the title. Why? I'll tell you why. Because then they don't want to make it any harder for that record to be broken again in the future, right? It's the same reason, like, Randy Orton is the youngest champion because Brock Lesnar left, and they couldn't have the youngest champion be a guy that's not there anymore. Yeah, I understand the logic behind this. So this means nothing. This speaks nothing to his performance, right? It's just predetermined. They're like, all right, we're going to make this guy into a star. It's kind of like, do you think Britney Spears is like on the same level as, let's say, Mariah Carey in terms of singing? Of course not, motherfuckers. But someone was like, hey, Britney, you're the one, kid. You're lucky. We're picking you to be the next star. So they market the shit out of her, right? They inflate her popularity. Eventually, that leads to real popularity. And like record-breaking sales, right? But it's not organic, right? And it's the same thing with Okada. It's not organic. Reason 10. Okada wrestles about 15 to 17 times a year, as far as I can tell. If that, motherfuckers. If that. This guy, at least in New Japan. New Japan, they have an event. Like, I don't think they've had an event since Wrestle Kingdom. It's been like over a month. They haven't had an event. They may have had like a bullshit event. Like, one of my friends went to an event they had in like Kansas City or whatever, like North Carolina or some shit, right? Like, he went there, but it was like Lance Archer, right? Lance Hoyt, motherfuckers. It was like Lance Archer and like Nabakishi guy, whatever the fuck his name is. A bunch of nobodies, you know? Like, the real ones don't wrestle. They wrestle very, very rarely, right? So, of course, then Okada can have like a 1 hour long match. He has a 1 hour long match 17 times a year, wrestles for 17 hours, right? Meanwhile, Seth Rollins, let's say, goes out there, wrestles in house shows, 20 minute matches, multiple times a week. You know what I mean? Just think about that for a second, motherfuckers. And it's not like Okada's wrestling 1 hour matches every time, right? Typically, it's like those bullshit New Japan, like 5-on-5 tag matches where each person wrestles for like 3 minutes. Anyways, reason 11, one of my favorites personally. Tajiri is better than Okada, and no one ever claimed that Tajiri is the GOAT, right? And that means to me that Okada sucks. Because if Tajiri's better than him, and nobody's saying Tajiri should be world champion, then there you go, motherfuckers. Why should Okada be anything but a Tajiri level, in my opinion, below Tajiri level type jobber, right? So there you have it. You know what I mean? That speaks for itself, if you ask me, motherfuckers. Reason number 12, he cries after losing matches. This is unbecoming of a champion, right? You don't cry when you lose matches. That's fucking weird. But if you're playing a real sport, right? Like, if you, let's say you're the Italian soccer team, motherfuckers, the Italian national soccer team, you make it to the World Cup finals and you lose in the last 3 minutes, someone scores a goal, let's say it's 1-1, they score a goal, 2-1, boom, you lose. Or you lose the World Cup like France did to Italy in penalties, right? That's heartbreaking, right? And you've worked for 4 years, you know, you don't get that many opportunities at the World Cup because it happens only once every 4 years, which means that if you miss your opportunity, you're like, fuck, what am I going to do now? I don't have another opportunity. I am totally fucked. You know, I can't do anything about it. I have to wait for 4 years. I might be 28 and 32. Some other 26-year-old may take my spot, right? So, you know, you might be overwhelmed with emotion because it's a real moment, right? And you might cry. And that's all right, whatever. It's still, you shouldn't do that. But in a fake sport, to cry? And I don't think his tears are fake. I think this is just the tears of a soft, soft man. You understand what I'm saying? All right, there we go. Okay, now my real favorite reason. We're getting to the meat of things, motherfuckers. Reason 13. Oh, my favorite reason is reason 25, of course, as usual. But this is one of my favorite reasons. Reason 13. People seem to think that Okada is this icon in Japan. Well, I got news for you, pal. He ain't. I spent 2 weeks in Tokyo 2 years ago, and I walked around Tokyo. I must have walked around every block of that some bitch. To put it into perspective, the first day I was there, right, I woke up at 5 a.m., and I walked around till like 4 p.m. Then I went to a hookah bar, smoked some hookah, and then I went back and partied, right? I walked 19 miles that day. 19 miles all over Tokyo. I did not see one mention of Okada. Now, the next day, I went to the Tokyo Dome because it's a historic some bitch. And I heard there was a New Japan wrestling store around the corner somewhere. It was actually a few blocks away. So I Googled it some bitch, found it, because one of my friends wanted me to go and take some pictures for him. And I did not even see a poster of Okada on the way there. He is so irrelevant that, like, he's not a star by any means. This is not like this pop culture celebrity, right? He's not like The Rock was in the 90s. He's not even like John Cena is now. You know, he's a nothing. He's a nobody. He's a goose egg. You know what I'm saying? So there you have it. Reason 14, which builds up from reason 13. Japanese people don't really give a rat's ass about wrestling, motherfuckers. While I was in Tokyo, I checked to see if there were any New Japan shows to go to, right? There were a few, but they were like bullshit shows. They were like 20 bucks, man. 20 bucks to go there, you know? 20 bucks, and it was like irrelevant wrestlers. I mean, like, you know, they had like, what's it called? Who's the champion now? I forget his name. Tatsuya Naito. He was in one of the matches, you know? So I was like, but I don't want to, like, it wasn't even the money. I was just like, I don't want to waste 3 hours of my life watching this garbage, this drollery, you know what I'm saying? And it wasn't even at the Tokyo Dome, it was just some bullshit place. So I'm like, I'm not taking a train all the way there to go see this when it's like a Saturday night, you know, in Tokyo, where I can do whatever the fuck I want. So the Japanese people don't really care about this. It's not this mainstream sport. They don't give a shit. I'll tell you this, at the Tokyo Dome, there was a store that, what's it called? That sold merchandise, right? For things and people that perform consistently at the Tokyo Dome. There was a lot of merchandise from what apparently is a baseball team called the Tokyo Giants, motherfuckers. The Tokyo Giants, right? Full of merchandise from these motherfuckers. I think they even have their own store, the Tokyo Giants. Not one thing to be seen from New Japan. In fact, the New Japan store was like out of the way. It was like maybe a 15-minute walk from there, a couple of blocks down, right? In this bullshit little basement, right? The store was like as big as my kitchen. It was a tiny, tiny store. So Japanese people don't give a fuck about this. And I believe that this is Okada's fault because he's their champion and he cannot make wrestling mainstream, motherfucker. So deal with it. Reason 15. He is called the Rainmaker, and that makes no sense. All right? Makes zero sense. No one cares, motherfuckers. Reason 16. He frequently, that's right, motherfuckers, frequently botches moves, right? A lot of people are going to think, no, he doesn't botch anything. He botches the Rainmaker multiple times because he doesn't do it consistently ever. He misses his top rope dropkick or the standing dropkick several times in like a 3 month period, right? He just misses it completely, right? This guy is not a good, like, athlete, period, motherfuckers, period, right? Reason 17, he could not make it in TNA and was sent back to New Japan in the jobber leagues. Now, I kind of hinted at this a little earlier, right? It's one thing to be a jobber in TNA, especially to be a foreign jobber, right? But for example, there was a guy called Kiyoshi in TNA. And this guy was put in like a group called World Elite with Eric Young, right? This was a pretty serious group. They were like not a main event group, but they were like an upper mid-card like force, right? They aligned themselves with like Immortal or whatever. There was like a whole story behind this group. And Kiyoshi was one of the dudes there, right? They didn't put Okada in that some bitch because they're like, no, Kiyoshi's better than Okada. It's as simple as that. They're like, all right, Kiyoshi's like cooler. He's probably better in the ring. He's more athletic. And Okada sucks. That's probably what they thought. So they gave him a shit gimmick. And he couldn't make it there. He couldn't make it there even though he was put in some somewhat like high-profile feuds. And as a jobber, he wasn't there. He was like the third guy in the feud. But nobody connected with him. No one cared. And no one back then was like, man, this guy? Oh, give this guy a push. He's so great. What they said was, who the fuck is this guy? Get him off my TV, motherfuckers. So that's what happened. Then we have reason 18. Everyone in New Japan, and there might be an exception here and there, like Kenny Omega was in good shape, and they had that Kitamura guy who's now gone. But everyone in New Japan, basically, is out of shape. They're fat little piglets, right? Will Ospreay's in good shape. Some of the foreigners are in good shape because they have aspirations to make it to WWE one day, so they have to be in good shape. But a lot of the New Japan people are just in horrible shape. When I watched Wrestle Kingdom, I was shocked and disgusted at what shape Naito was in. This guy won like the two main titles, and he just looked like a pudgy little shit. I mean, this guy's never had like a godlike physique, but he just looked like he let himself go, you know? And I was watching, who was I watching with? Like, someone was in my apartment doing some work. Maybe it was my girlfriend who was doing some schoolwork. And I was like, babe, look at this pudgy little shit, right? And she was like, oh, come on, don't be mean, right? And I'm just like, I'm not trying to be mean here, you know what I'm saying? It's whatever. It's okay to let yourself go once in a while. But it's not okay to let yourself go when you're about to win, like, the two biggest titles in your promotion, right, at the biggest event of the year. Do you understand what I'm saying, motherfuckers? I heard this interview with Bill Burr. And Bill Burr, who's a comic, for those of you that don't know, he said that even when he has, like, a cameo role for a movie, he tries to get to at least 170 pounds because he knows that's when he's not fat, right? Even for a cameo role, this guy tries to get in shape, and he's a comic. This compared to a quote-unquote pro athlete who does not get in the best shape he can be in at the equivalent of New Japan's WrestleMania. This just goes to show the work ethic of New Japan, right? And speaking of Naito, who I actually like more than most, right? This guy, his finishing move is botched nearly every time he does it. You know, it's supposed to be almost like a reverse tilt-a-whirl type DDT, like the Salida del Sol, except when he does the flip, he almost always has his feet touch the ground. It's just goofy as shit. It doesn't look like a finisher at all. So there you go, man. Everyone's a jobber, and this guy is the king of these jobbers, so it doesn't mean anything to me. You know, it means nothing. Like, being the best there means absolutely zero. You know, it's like being the best at, like, I don't know, Northern Florida Championship Wrestling. Who gives a fuck? You know what I mean? Reason number 19. He is a multiple-time champion, but when John Cena is mentioned as a multiple-time champion, he still sucks. For some reason, this is considered a positive for Okada, but a negative for people like Cena and Orton and Triple H, you know, who is a great wrestler, but a shitty booker, in my opinion. Reason 20. If John Cena were to go to New Japan, he would be Grand Slam champion in about 2 minutes, and in my opinion, would have better matches than Okada. If John Cena only had to wrestle 17 times a year, John Cena would be having 10-star matches if Okada's having 5-star matches. Get the fuck out of here, dog. Reason 21. No one, even Dave Meltzer, no one thinks that Okada is actually good. They just pretend to think that so they seem like better fans, right? This is a very weird phenomenon with wrestling fans. Like, they think that liking weird... Well, it's not just wrestling fans, I guess. It's not just wrestling fans. You know, if you ever got into a debate, like, with someone about, like, for example, who's the best basketball player? Everyone gets into this, right? Or specifically, who's the best point guard? John Stockton is the answer, motherfuckers. But there's room for debate. You can be like, John Stockton, maybe it's Magic Johnson. I don't know. You know, Magic Johnson's a better player overall, but he's a better point guard. He's a really good one. You know what I'm saying? That kind of shit. But let's talk about best player. Who's the best player? There's three acceptable answers to that. The answers are Michael Jordan, motherfuckers, LeBron James, deal with it, cuckus, and of course, rest in peace, Kobe Bryant, right? These are the three that typically are involved in this conversation. Periodically, you'll have some basketball smark, right? Just like wrestling has smarts, every sport has smarts. You'll have some guy who'll be like, oh, I think Scottie Pippen is the best player of all time. Oh, I think Robert Horry is the best. Like, you shut the fuck up. No, he's not. You know what I'm saying? They're like, oh, Karl Malone. It's not Karl Malone, motherfuckers. It's one of the three that I just mentioned at the end. Even Larry Bird, you know, who's like, who might be in like in a top five contention just for his impact, right? Like, it's not. You know, it's obviously not. Michael Jordan is better than these motherfuckers, you know? Or in my opinion, LeBron's the best. But you know, you understand what I'm saying? Like, there's room for debate amongst those three. But when you start bringing in bullshit scenarios, then you lose all credibility, right? But for some reason, Dave Meltzer doesn't lose all credibility. It's like, who's the best wrestler of all time? Is it Hogan? Is it Flair? Maybe it's Shawn Michaels. No, I think it's Okada. Get the fuck out of here. It's complete nonsense, right? It's stupid. Nobody really likes this guy. They just pretend to do it to seem like they know more, right? Because when someone says to you, well, I think actually Chris the Birdman Anderson is the best NBA player of all time, what they're really saying is, hey, aren't you impressed that I know who Chris the Birdman Anderson is? And the answer to that question, motherfuckers, is almost always no, nerd. All right? So let's get to it. We're getting to the end of our list, which makes me sad because I could talk about how much this guy sucks all day, motherfuckers. So reason 22. He has a stupid name. Stupid ass name. It's a girly name, motherfuckers. Kazuchika Okada. Or as I like to call him, Kazuchika. The word chica is in his name, motherfuckers. That's a broad's name, right? I don't give a rat's ass. There's cool Japanese names like Hotaru. You know what I'm saying? Hotaka. Anything like that. It's cool to me. Minoru. They got a lot of cool names, but not Kazuchika. That's a stupid name. Kazuchika Okada, girl name. Shut up, girl name. Why are you the world champion, girl name? What a dumb girl name. Reason 23. He has a girly appearance and does not, which fits his name, but does not fit the mold of a world champion. You take someone like Orton, and it's clear. When JBL says, if you had to make a superstar from scratch, he'd look like Randy Orton, Maggle, right? That makes sense. That makes sense. You see why. You're like, man, Randy Orton is chiseled from stone. This guy is just jacked. You know, he's like great looking. He's got a great physique. You know, he's athletic, right? He feels like a star. You know, he looks like a badass, right? But not Okada. Oh, JBL would never say that about Okada. You know what JBL would do to Okada? If Okada went to WWE, JBL would bully him like he did Rene Dupree and send him back to Japan where he could be a jobber for the rest of his life. But by the way, what the fuck happened to Yoshitatsu? You know what I'm saying? This guy went to WWE, failed completely, went to Japan, failed there too. That says a lot, you know? Anyways, it is what it is. Reason 24, and now we're getting to the two most important reasons. Reason 24, despite stealing D'Angelo De Niro's gimmick, like I said earlier, Okada has no gimmick because he stole the irrelevant part of D'Angelo De Niro's gimmick. D'Angelo Danero's gimmick hinges upon the fact that this is a man of great influence due to his ability to speak very well and the fact that he is a shady, shady motherfucker, right? So he makes money come from the ceilings, right? He opens his arms, like I said, and money falls from the ceilings, right? You can look this up on YouTube, motherfuckers. I ain't making this up. And this fits his character because he's the Pope, D'Angelo Danero. You know what I'm saying, motherfuckers? He's the Pope. He's supposed to be this overconfident, like, guy who has a lot of money that he probably got through nefarious means, like getting donations, like a Reverend Devon almost, right? And that's kind of what the storyline was eventually for D'Angelo Danero. He was a guy that was taking money for, like, charities, basically, and he was using it on his own lavish lifestyle. He's basically, you know, those, like, televangelists that say, like, donate now and I'll, like, you know, take the evil spirit out of you, and they live in these, like, mega mansions. He's basically that, except, like, on a street level, and he's also a wrestler, motherfuckers. So that's why he's great. Now, Okada stole only the part where money falls from the ceiling. He didn't steal the actual character, right? Which is what made D'Angelo Danero cool. He just stole his mannerisms and his money falling from the ceiling. Now, this is a great segue to Reason 25, because now I'm going to talk a little bit about why Okada stole D'Angelo Danero's gimmick. If you're unaware, you're probably thinking to yourself, well, how do you know he stole it? Like I said earlier, how do you know he stole it, right? It's just, what connects D'Angelo Danero with Kazuchika Okada? I'll tell you, motherfuckers, I'm glad you asked. What connects them is this. When Okada came to TNA, and this is Reason 25, he came in as a guy called Okado, right? Now, as stupid as the name Okado is, considering his name is Okada, that's how close it is, it's even dumber when you consider that Okado's gimmick was that of Kato from Green Hornet. He was Kato from Green Hornet, and slash, he was a cameraman for guess who, motherfucks? Everyone's favorite fat ass, Samoa Joe. So Samoa Joe was convinced that D'Angelo Danero was stealing money from innocents, so he hired Okado, who dressed up like Kato, by the way, as you can see in the picture that I put up on this video. He hired Okado to follow D'Angelo Danero and film him doing nefarious things. So this cocksucker, with a Kato outfit, would go around and he would film D'Angelo Danero until D'Angelo Danero found him and whooped that ass, right? So this is what connects him to D'Angelo Danero and to TNA and to the gimmick that he stole. Basically, they sent him to TNA and they're like, all right, find yourself because you're just a Japanese jobber. You know, the Japanese have those jobbers that only wear black tights. He sent him on his excursion and he went there, right? And when he went there, all he did was he stole D'Angelo Danero's gimmick, right? But more important than that, while he was in TNA, again, Reason 25, he was Okado, motherfuckers. I don't think I've ever seen a more jobber gimmick in my life than Okado. And this guy, the guy that played Okado, you expect me to understand and accept without any evidence suggesting so, that this guy is now one of the best wrestlers of all time? Have you lost your fucking mind, motherfuckers? As far as I'm concerned, Okada should revert back to his Okado gimmick, go to TNA, and start jobbing to Tessa Blanchard, because that would actually make sense. And with that being said, I gotta tell you this, motherfuckers. This video, I have enjoyed a lot. I have enjoyed making this video quite a bit. And the reason why I've enjoyed it quite a bit is because it is 100% the truth. Sometimes I joke around and I'll say things like, oh man, like here's 25 reasons why, I don't know, Kenny Omega sucks, right? Which I believe, don't get me wrong, Kenny Omega does suck. But some of those reasons are bullshit reasons. Like, oh, Kenny Omega, like, dressed up as Princess Jasmine, right? Which, I mean, it's obviously a good reason, but you understand what I'm saying. It's a non-wrestling related reason. In this context, well, it is. So that's not a good example, but you understand what I'm saying. In this context, every reason that I can give about Okado is valid. It's 100% true, motherfuckers. It's not even like an opinion. It's fact of life, right? And just to put the cherry on top of the ice cream sundae up in this bitch, when I got into an argument in that little jobber's, YouTube stream, I said, nobody cares about Okado. And this smart beard, immediately he was like, oh, his name's not Okado, it's spelled Okada. And I'm like, ah, oh, you jobber. You don't even know what you're being fed. You don't even know. You're just a consumer, like one of those idiot consumers that's like, here's some shit, eat it, you know, and you eat it, oh, it's good, you know what I mean? No thoughts whatsoever, you don't even know. And I'm not going to sit here and say, oh, you need to know the history to be a fan, of course not. But when I say Okado, I'm not saying it for no reason, motherfucker. I'm saying it because this guy, the lasting impression that he's left on my brain is that of Okado, the Kato wearing, the Kato dressing, Kato named, Kato themed, cameraman gimmick having, some bitch, sidekick to Samoa Joe on TNA. Now look at Samoa Joe. A potato? Yes. A fat piece of crap? Yes. A WWE superstar? Yes. Okado, on the other hand, no, fam. No way, dog. And maybe he might go to WWE one day and he will have a Nakamura career, let's be honest. This guy is not a Vince McMahon guy, which means he looks like a guy that Vince McMahon would beat the shit out of for no reason whatsoever. And with that, motherfucks, this day became a two-for-one day because I was feeling very, very talkative today. You understand me? So there you have it. You know, I'm going to check. I got two notifications here probably from the video. I just want to... There it is. I was just saying that... seeing if there was maybe another subscriber I could just include in this video. But no, the only one that we got since the last video, which was less than an hour ago, is Too Debonair, 1914, welcome motherfucks. And with that, I'll let you guys go. Stay dirty and go, fuck yes, sir.